Okay, friends, it's a great pleasure to be participating in a conference like this. This takes you, you know, for example, I have been actively involved in research, but having thought of the kind of problems, kind of questions which are being asked in this particular, you know, conference, I am, you may say that not really one who has been working or who has been a kind of, you know, follower on these type of problems. However, this session is, what is mathematics? Let us see, do we, whatever we say, we talk, what is, what we know about or what are our doubts or questions or methods and all that and all that. But what is mathematics? It still remains. And I recall there is a shlok by 9th century mathematician Mahaviracharya. Some of you may have read his work and all that and all that. And he said, Bahubir pralape kim. In Sanskrit, pralap means that you know, get restless and complain and, you know, worried about and all that and all that. Bahubiru. Why do too much of the, you know, getting upset on things that you are not able to handle? Bahubiru pralape kim. Trilokya. In our, you know, tradition, we consider that there are three lokas. So you may be on one loka, which we consider the present life, the human life or other animal lives which are here are on one particular loka, and then there is a swarga and there is a narak and all that, the three lokas. So even after death, even before the birth, you may be in some stage, in some particular loka, in some particular, you know, thing. So bahubir pralape kim trilokya. And sacharachare, there you may be a person who is the life, who is movable or is inert. So trilokya sacharachare, and then yad kinchit vastu. If there is something in this particular wider world of three, you know, kind of, let's say, the look at what you can call the, if yad kinchita vastu tray lok se ganite inda bina nahi, anything which you find in the three worlds is amongst the moving objects or among the inner objects in the three worlds, if you have not, there is nothing in the world which will not have its mathematics. So the only thing is that mathematics is a big resolution of any kind of problem with anything which may exist in the three world, and that way spirituality automatically becomes a part of the study of mathematics, because there may be a problem that we have seen already. And the other part that way is, you know, so mathematics is such a, any kind of a problem, not only for this world, but the other two worlds also, and for whatever kind of things you face and you get, you are not able to solve, it is, you have not done its proper mathematics. That's what this particular shloka of 9th century means. Of course, today we are realizing that with more of technology coming and the advancements which are making in the information world, actually information theory has been my major area of activity right from the time it picked up fast, and that way that's more of my area of publications and research and my, you know, PhD students and all that. So I know how it has grown and how it has gone and all that and all that. The actual problem which we are going to talk today, my title, Meta-Mathematics, Logicism, Intuitionism and Formalism in Mathematics, which ultimately goes to talk about the perspectives and foundations of mathematics. I think, has very largely been covered. It was very beautifully covered, and I was talking to our Varunji, that look, you have covered all these topics very well. And thereafter, Professor Jolta also has gone much beyond and all that and all that. So I was a little, thinking that, look, what I may be presenting, maybe my way of simply putting things in a certain fashion, but the topics have been well covered. But let me begin something as we do. All right, so let's go to the next. Oh, should I go or what is the system? Aap karenge? Oh, okay. Achha, kaise karenge? Okay, all right. Achha, okay, all right, thank you. This is, okay. Mathematics, it is the study of mathematics itself, the meta-mathematics, it is the study of mathematics itself using mathematical methods. The study produces meta-theories, which are mathematical theories about the mathematical theories. Emphasis on mathematics owes, goes to Hilbert's attempt to secure the foundations of mathematics in the early part of 20th century. Meta-mathematics provides a rigorous mathematical technique for investigating a great variety of foundation problems for mathematics. So friends, when we talk of meta-mathematics, this is what it is. The word was picked up by, okay. And the three topics which I have chosen, logicism, intuitionism and formalism, and that way we go to the quest for foundations of mathematics. The problems, how does it arise? It arises because there are classical problems and there are other problems which are defying solutions. Paradoxes, we already learned about paradoxes. The fundamental questions on the soundness of foundations of mathematics. And some of the things which, as a diagnosis, we go to lack of systematic approach. Mathematics probably is not systematically approached, and that can probably find one of the reasons for this. Lack of rigor in defining concepts. And the third thing that I find is imprecise language, mainly natural language, being a little, not that perfect in representing the mathematical ideas. So these are some of the things of my structure of presentation. Okay, what are some of the remedies? Systematic approach may be considered. Mathematics may be considered as a system. Axiomatic approach, which is already considered for foundations. Number system and geometry example. Precise symbolic formal language to define concepts. So language is another area where we can do a little improvement in improving the foundations or the problems which are arising in this. Symbolic language, I think the best example that we have on symbolic language perfect is that of Panini's Ashtadhyayi, earliest example of formalism, and so far one of the best that we know. And I'm sorry. Okay. I'm not able to handle it so well. Okay. So I was talking about Panini. Anyway, the things that will come.
Next, I'll do.
Okay. So I said that there are certain problems. Some of the outstanding problem was the squaring of the circle, which was proved impossible by Ferdinand von Lindemann in 1882. Doubling the cube, which was proved impossible by pair Wenzel in 1837, trisecting the angle proved impossible by pair Wenzel in this. Okay, next, let's go to the next. Some of the recent ones, Fermat's last theorem, we know that the first successful proof was released in 1994 by Andrew Wiles, running into 100 pages and using advanced level of mathematics from different branches. Four color problem, which was first proposed by Francis Guthrie, comparatively recently in 1852. It was proved in 1976 by Apple and Haken. And I remember that in 1976, when I went to USA for the first time from India, I found that on the envelopes, this was almost written, the four letters, the four colors suffice. This was such a great thing, felt by the whole, the humanity, that four colors suffice. So that was a letter on the envelopes and all that and all that. So this is there. Questions of paradoxes, Zeno's paradox. We all know there are about 10, 12 of them, and they are very simple, and one laughs at this to why such kind of things came. And this was resolved. This was resolved, in fact, by the limiting idea, which in our Indian school, Kerala School of Astronomy and Mathematics, in 1314 to 14, this by Madhava, he was the person who preceded in defining the idea of what is the concept of limit, which was later on in 14th century was found by Cauchy as such. So these somehow the two problems that came up is Laird's paradox, logically a problem. Mr. X says, I was already quoted, in the last presentation, I am telling lies. If you take it right, you go to take it false. If you take it false, then in that case, you turn out to be right. So naturally, this logically, this creates a problem. And I think there is yet somehow this has got to be resolved further and all that and all that. So what is true and what is false, there is a contradiction here that we see immediately. Then comes about the fifth postulate, which was, of course, a very major at that time, or even today, it may be considered to one of the very major kind of breakthrough that you try to find, make changes in the fifth postulate. First, of course, there was an attempt to see if the first postulate could be derived from other four postulates. But once that was established, then in that case, it was found that you can change it. And there was a generalization, very strong generalization of two types of the, Lepchovsky's was one, and then the other method was there. So this is how it came later on. After this fifth postulate, this greatly encouraged, some of the meta-mathematical approaches and all that. Now, the question is to see the inner kind of difficulties. Look at the very simple idea that there is a point xy, and there is a point x plus dx and y plus dy. And let's go a little further. So if we take the, please go to the next one. Okay, let's consider a very simple case, x square plus 2xy is equal to 5. Replace x by x plus dx and y plus dy and simplify. And if you, after simplification, I'm having problem.
You want to go to the next?
Next.
On
क्या करना है ऊपर
अर्लियर पीछे
अर्लियर हाँ पीछे नहीं पीछे नहीं गया अभी I should be able to. Okay, no. It's going further, child. Ah, that's all right.
This is only for this button.
Hmm? Acha. Acha. Or ye jo color.
This one, big one, this middle one.
Ha. No, no. Wo karne ke liye. Anyway, the things that we find here is x plus delta x L square twice x. This one, and we expand it. Then in that case, you can replace x square plus twice xy plus 5 equal to 0, and then you get the relation that twice x dx plus twice y dy and all that equal to 0. Ultimately, this gives the value of dy dx equal to 0 on taking delta x square equal to 0 and delta y square equal to 0. Something which you did not consider 0 in the beginning, but ultimately if you were to ordinarily differentiate it, this is what the result you would have got, dy dx is equal to minus x plus y over x, this would have been. Now by actually proceeding with the concept that you replace x plus y, x plus delta x and y plus y delta y, you will not get that result unless you take delta x square equal to 0 delta y equal to delta y square equal to 0. So there is something which mathematically at one stage you are considering different from 0, at other stage you are considering it equal to 0 and not 0 on 0. So that way there is for this kind of a thing, there is a in mathematics, within mathematics the approach has a little lacuna that delta xy square equal to 0 and delta xy equal to 0 is considered. I'm really sorry to not able to handle it well. So the small quantities delta x and delta y were called infinitesimals or differentials by them. Even Newton and Leibniz were aware of the problem, but Bishop George Berkeley in 1734 essay entitled The Analysis, subtitled A Course Discourse in Infidel Mathematics, he called it, mathematics right. And what we are, these infinitesimals, they are neither finite quantities, nor quantities infinitely small, nor yet nothing. Maybe we can call them ghosts of departed quantities. By virtue of a twofold mistake, you arrive, though not at a science, yet at a truth. So you are not approaching, you know, consistently, and you are finding the difference when you consider things like this. So by virtue of a twofold, actually Bishop apprehended that successful application of calculus to science will reduce pupils' faith in God. He went to saying that this will reduce to faith of God, but anyway, this objection was justified. I'm sorry, I went. Okay, all right, diagnostic. Latest by beginning of 19th century, the issues discussed up to now made mathematicians search more seriously for the reasons for the problematic situations. It was found mathematics lacks systematic approach, rigor in defining the concepts and descriptions of procedures for solution of problems, precise language, mathematics being communicated and practiced by natural language like English creates problem. This was the other part which was there. कहीं हम गड़बड़ कर रहे हैं
सिस्टम इज हियर वी हैड टू शो दिस
हैं
यू गिव टू हिम एंड टेल प्रीवियस और नेक्स्ट
ओके ऑलराइट remedial measures, it was discussed that various branches of mathematics, for example, probability theory, analytic and projective geometries, infinitesimal calculus, mathematical analysis, modern algebra, non-Euclidean geometry, etc., each have apparently its own individual concepts and methods. And methods, hold on, yeah, let's go back. And methods and tools, approaches of that are hardly appearing to be constituents of a single unified discipline. So it was not a unified discipline. Only as a system we can talk of coherence, logical consistency, redundancy, compactness and completeness of a mathematical theory of body of mathematical knowledge. So this is how remedial thing idea was developed and all that and all that. Yes, please, now go to the next. Yeah, we can go to the next, yeah. In order to make mathematics a coherent whole, it was decided to take natural numbers and later set and some concepts of geometry like point and line as fundamental. What are the fundamental things that was, you know, initially considered? Also, it was found that axiomatic approach appropriate for sound foundation of mathematics. Yes, please. And remedial measures. Natural numbers process was started by Grassmann in 1860, Pierce in 1881, and Dedekind in 1888. They proposed axiomatic system for natural numbers. Then Peano followed and published the simplified version of these axioms. So this is another approach to correct and all that. For geometries, axiom system was proposed amongst others by Pasch, by Pach, by Hilbert. For Euclidean geometry, Stude and Veblen, and each other significant contribution to approximation of projective geometry. Zermelo, Franklin, and Scholm proposed axioms for set theory. So there came a field that everything you want to define may be best put in terms of the axioms. Yes, please. Now, consider the most serious problems of the ills of mathematics was diagnosed as the use of natural language. And how to consider this? Consider two newspaper reports. Look at them. Harsh Rawat, the chief minister of Uttarakhand, he speaks so sweetly. But the word sweet is not in the same, you know, it hasn't got the same meaning. So sweet ultimately may be inference as if he becomes diabetic. In the next sentence, look at it. This was reported in Hindustan Times about the weather of the previous day. It was Friday. Now, fry is interpreted as one very hot. And in that sense, 44.7 degree, you know, the language, the use of the language can create a problem, and these are some of the examples which are reported in the paper as such. Okay. Here are some quotations. A diplomat is someone who can tell you to go to hell in such a way that you will look forward to the trip. Very, you know, the language is a game becoming and all that and all that. Do not argue with an idiot. He will drag you down to his level and beat you up with his idiotic experience. Light, the third one probably you will enjoy more. Light travels faster than sound. This is a very simple physical law. This is why some people appear bright until you hear them speak. Because their sound will come later, the light comes earlier, and therefore they may look like that. So there are certain ambiguities or certain kind of problems which arise because of this. Of course, the natural language expresses human feelings of joy, sorrow, humor, surprise, etc. quite satisfactorily, especially through various figures of speech, idioms, metaphors, smiles, and irony. However, these figures of speech make a natural language ambiguous, vague, imprecise, and even inconsistent, and hence make a natural language unsuitable for mathematical or the or scientific language, where objectivity clearly consists of meaning of foremost. Yeah, please. Now, for arriving at the impracticable, impossible mathematical truth, an approach and a notion is required, notation is required, which helps in defining concepts unambiguously, in making judgments or decisions correctly, and in deriving conclusions intuitively. For this purpose, a systematic approach and proper symbolic notation is required. A natural language is deficient for some of the purposes in mathematics. This led to movement of developing artificial symbolic formal language for mathematics. And let us see, when we try to do that, what kind of problems we face. Okay. All right. Boole, in the Western world, 19th century, it was started by Boole through his law of thought, and he is said to initiate symbolic movement in the West. Cantor, on the other hand, provided new foundation for mathematics in terms of set theory. Frege, well, such an eminent person like him, though, you know, he formal language for pure thought modeled on that of arithmetic made a turning point in the history of logic and mathematics. Later on, Russell, Whitehead, Gödel, and among others made significant contributions in the field. Now, I'm quoting here Professor C.R. Rao, one of the very eminent statisticians of the world, and myself and Professor Rao worked together for several. There was a society for which he was the president and I was the secretary, working with him for 4 years. He says that on this book, which is very widely read, has a long antiquity, but not that old history. It has a short history, but it has antiquity. This is true about any one of the things, and therefore the question is that the things of the past keep on always interacting or reflecting on the present as they are. So is true of symbolism and formalism. So ultimately, this problem okay. In India, robust symbolic systems were developed, as I told you, in around 6th century BC, which culminated in